Welcome to our St. John's Parish family on this 21st Sunday in Ordinary Time. We especially welcome all who are visiting with us. At this Mass, we remember in a special way Mary Ann Lyon. Please stand and give a sign of welcome to those around you. We begin our liturgy singing number 533 in the Gather Hymnal, All Creatures of Our God and King, number 533.
Creatures of our God.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My dear friends, welcome on this 21st Sunday in Ordinary Time, when we hear the grand finale of the Bread of Life Discourse, Jesus' great homily on the Eucharist, where he speaks of his flesh as true food and his blood as true drink. And today we will hear the response of the people to his words. We too have responded with our actions as well as our words by being here at this Mass and proclaiming, as Saint Peter has said in the Gospel, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We are convinced you are the Son of God. That's why we're here. And therefore, we pray for all those that are not here with us, that they too may have the conviction that we do. We pray for those that are homebound and that would want to be here, but are physically unable. We pray for all those that are traveling, and we pray for those that are fallen away, that they may return home. As we begin this Mass, we first pause to reflect on the ways in which we encounter the Son of God in the world, and the times that we have failed to honor the divine presence in our lives, and therefore we ask for mercy.
Lord Jesus, you came into this world out of love for creation. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ Jesus, you come into our lives to show us the way. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you will come again to bring peace to all. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. And may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Jesus Christ, only begotten Son,
O God, who caused the minds of the faithful to unite in a single purpose, grant your people to love what you command and to desire what you promise, that amid the uncertainties of this world, our hearts may be fixed on that place where true gladness is found. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Joshua. Joshua gathered together all the tribes of Israel at Shechem, summoning their elders, their leaders, their judges, and their officers. When they stood in ranks before God, Joshua addressed all the people. If it does not please you to serve the Lord, decide today whom you will serve. The gods your fathers served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose country you are now dwelling. As for me, my household, we will serve the Lord. But the people answered, far be it from us to forsake the Lord for the service of other gods. For it was the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up out of the land of Egypt, out of a state of slavery. He performed those great miracles before our very eyes and protected us along our entire journey and among the peoples through whom we passed. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God. The word of the Lord.
Our psalm is number 34, Taste and See, number 34.
Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. Taste and see the goodness of the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall be ever in my mouth. Let my soul
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Ephesians. Brothers and sisters, be subordinate to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives should be subordinate to their husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is head of his wife, just as Christ is head of the church, he himself the Savior of the body. As the church is subordinate to Christ, so wives should be subordinate to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church and handed himself over for her to sanctify her, cleansing her by the bath of water with the word, that he might present to himself the church in splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. So also husbands should love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself, for no one hates his own flesh, but rather nourishes it and cherishes it, even as Christ does the church, because we are members of his body. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. This is a great mystery, but I speak in reference to Christ and the church. The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to John. Many of Jesus' disciples who were listening said, "This saying is hard. Who can accept it?" Since Jesus knew that his disciples were murmuring about this, he said to them, "Does this shock you? What if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life, while the flesh is of no avail. The words I have spoken to you are Spirit and life, but there are some of you who do not believe." Jesus knew from the beginning the ones who would not believe and the one who would betray him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted to him by my Father." As a result of this, many of his disciples returned to their former way of life and no longer accompanied him. Jesus then said to the 12, "Do you also want to leave?" Simon Peter answered him, "Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. If you ever travel to Europe, to the great cathedrals and churches, and see the magnificent tombs of the past, usually tombs of kings and nobles, you will notice a very interesting feature. Usually, at the feet of the person buried is a dog, a sculpture of a dog. It's not the pet of that nobleman or monarch that is sculpted because of the love that person had for animals. Instead, that imagery of the dog symbolizes fidelity, symbolizes faithfulness, that the person who died and is buried in that tomb was a faithful man or woman to God, regardless if they had a dog or not. It's a sign of that fidelity, faithfulness to God. The English poet Alexander Pope has a very clever saying in which he says, "I am my master's dog at Kew. Pray tell me, sir, whose dog are you?" Similarly, in more modern times, in one of his songs, Bob Dylan says that all of us serve a master. The question becomes, which one? Whose dog are we? Who do we belong to? Who are we faithful to? Who is our master? Who is our Lord? Joshua asked that question in today's first reading from the Hebrew Scriptures, the Old Testament of the Bible, where he says, "Decide today whom you will serve. Will you serve our God, or will you serve a false idol?" Among the most faithful of the Israelites on that journey to the Promised Land that made a firm declaration in word and deed that he is faithful to the Lord Almighty was a man named Caleb, a companion of Joshua, a friend, a fellow leader. And that name, Caleb, in Hebrew means dog. It's not a pejorative that he was called a dog. It was a sign of great loyalty that he had, not just to Moses and Joshua, but above all to God. And down the centuries and ages to this day, there are people whose name is Caleb. The question becomes for us, whom do we serve? We claim to serve God, but most often, unfortunately, other things get in the way of serving God. And we turn away. And we either go back to former ways of life or seek satisfaction elsewhere or claim to prioritize God but not act upon it. In fact, sadly, the sin that I find that most people commit and few confess is the first commandment, to have no other gods before us. And we can say, well, of course, I don't worship Zeus or a pagan god. I am a Catholic Christian and not part of another religion. But do our interests, hobbies, work, other commitments get in the way of that which should be first and foremost, that worship of God. Notice that Jesus says that the greatest commandment is to love God with all our hearts and all our souls and all our strength, and then our neighbor as ourself. Not just to love God, or to love God a lot, but to love God with all that we have and all that we are. To walk in lockstep with God, the way Joshua and Caleb did in the Old Testament, and the way Peter did in today's gospel. We have to make that decision for ourselves each and every day. Whom will I serve today? Will I put God above all else, and therefore my devotion to God, my worship of God, my prayer to God, my attentiveness to God first and foremost, and then everything will follow? Or will I leave God hanging and turn elsewhere? One of the most heartbreaking sentences in all of sacred scripture is found in today's gospel. And interestingly enough, it is the 66th verse of the 6th chapter of the Gospel of John. In other words, it is John 6:66. Many of his disciples returned to their former way of life and no longer accompanied Jesus. They turned their back on Jesus, turned their back on his teaching. And he stood there and witnessed that. Imagine the heartbreak that he must have felt. But he did not run after them. He stood his ground. And actually, he doubled down. He turned to the 12 apostles and said, "Do you also want to leave?" In other words, he's echoing what Joshua said. Whom will you follow? Whom will you serve? And interestingly, the name Jesus is the Greek and Latin version of Joshua. In Hebrew, Joshua and Jesus are the same name. Could imagine how tense the air was, how the apostles, seeing probably hundreds of people leave, themselves being at a crossroads. What do we do? How do we respond? And who speaks up, not just on his own behalf, but on behalf of all the apostles? It is Peter, Simon Peter, the same one who elsewhere in the Gospels spoke up when Jesus said, "Who do you say that I am?" And it's Peter that made that profession of faith that you are the Son of God. And here again, Peter makes that profession of faith in Christ. "Master," notice what he says, "Master, you are my master. Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and are convinced that you are the Holy One of God." Again, Peter makes that profession of faith. And it's upon this profession of faith of Peter that the church is built by Christ. And it's within the church of Peter, within that profession of faith of Peter, that we receive the Eucharist. Because today's gospel is the fourth and final installment of Jesus's great homily on the Eucharist. And it's Peter who proclaims that he has come to believe, and he, together with the others, are convinced that Jesus is the Holy One of God who has given his flesh for the life of the world, and his flesh will remain with us as true food and true drink, so that we who eat his flesh and drink his blood will have eternal life. We have to make that same commitment ourselves. Not just seemingly stroll through life and somehow worshiping God in however way we can, somehow, sometimes falling short, sometimes stepping up, but kind of wandering and meandering. We need to be convinced. We need to be won over. We need to be firm in our commitment in this respect. I have had two incidences this week where teenagers that I have taught have made that firm commitment that Peter has made in today's gospel and Caleb in the Old Testament. Earlier this week, a student of mine, before going off to college, asked for the sacrament of reconciliation, confession. And he said to me that it dawned on him that very often he confesses how he's hurt others, how he's not been the best person that he could possibly be, but he rarely confesses the way he's let God down, how he's not been faithful to God, to going to Mass, to receiving the Eucharist. And he realized that as he's going off to college, away from his family, away from his local parish, away from the Catholic school that he graduated from, on his own, it would be so easy for him to get lost and have everything else get in the way, and to just give lip service to God. You know, God, I love you. Yeah, if I remember, I'll pray to you. But I have classes to go to, clubs to sign up for, new friends to meet, so many other activities to do. So I'll try to squeeze you in, but you know, life gets in the way. And you're God, you understand. And you realize that he could not have that attitude. So therefore, on the vigil, the night before he went off to college, he made that commitment that when he gets to college, he will make God that priority. Mass, the Eucharist, the priority. The Newman Center and Catholic ministry at the college, a priority. And then, figuring out his class schedule, figuring out the layout of the campus, friends that he's going to make, and all the rest will become secondary. That is a powerful, conscientious commitment to make for a very young 18-year-old. Similarly, a rising sophomore expressed to me that he wanted to be baptized, received into the church. This rising sophomore at the start of freshman year claimed to be an atheist, claimed to not believe in God, not believe in the divinity of Christ, and yet after a year of learning, discerning, He has come to believe and has become convinced that the words of Jesus Christ are true. And so therefore express that firm desire to be baptized and receive Holy Communion, the Eucharist, with his family present, his friends present. Those are two examples of very conscientious teenagers making a firm, definitive stand. More of us and more throughout the world need to make that definitive stand likewise. Not just to meander through life, but to walk through life with a purpose, with a direction, with a conviction, with a belief that is put into action. To be decisive in our relationship with God. To have that relationship be meaningful. And it's only then that will also be fulfilling for us. With a renewed sense of conviction, we profess our beliefs in the Trinitarian God. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God. Begotten, not made, consubstantial the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and see at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Master, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. With Peter's simple expression of faith echoing in our hearts, we raise our prayers to God.
Our response is, Lord, hear our prayer. That all members of the church may reject the values of society that contradict the gospel and choose to serve the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may deliver our world from its penchant for violence and set nations free to pursue reconciliation and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those whose faith has been tested may not walk away, but stay near Christ, who has the words of eternal life. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the wives and husbands of our parish community may continue to grow in love and be living signs of Christ's love for his church. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
that there may be an increase in vocations to the priesthood, the diaconate, the religious life, and holy matrimony. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all gathered here may, like Joshua's household, serve the Lord by their love and support of one another. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the sick and suffering, especially Stephen Nolan, Raymond Casillac, Maria Luisa Navarro, Leda Pachis, and baby Rita Aliamo, may know the Lord's love and healing touch. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have remained faithful to Christ in this life may see Christ, who ascended to where he was before. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
And for Mary Ann Lyon, for whom this Mass is being offered, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Father, your Son has the words of life. We have nowhere to go but to him. Our prayers are offered in his name, the Lord of the Church, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Our offertory hymn is number 708, I Danced in the Morning, number 708.
Sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, our good and holy God's Holy Church.
O Lord, who gained for yourself a people by adoption, through the one sacrifice offered once for all, bestow graciously on us, we pray, the gifts of unity and peace in your church, through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord God, Almighty Father, and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so with all the angels we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation. Giving thanks, they have held us worthy to be in his presence, to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Joseph, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy, welcome them into the light of your face, especially Mary Ann Lyon, for whom this Mass is offered. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, with St. Peter, St. Caleb, St. John the Baptist, and all the saints that pleased you throughout the ages, may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you, dear Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. as true disciples of Christ, who have come to believe and are convinced that he is the Son of God, we say the prayer that he himself taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
With your spirit. Let us offer one another a sign of peace.
Takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and your soul shall be healed.
Our communion hymn is number 522, Glory and Praise to Our God, number 522.
Daughters and
Let us pray. Complete within us, O Lord, we pray, the healing work of your mercy, and graciously perfect and sustain us so that in all things we may please you through Christ our Lord. Please remember to take a copy of the bulletin with you home. There's important information, especially regarding our religious education program for registration, specifically First Reconciliation, First Holy Communion preparation, as well as confirmation prep. Also, this Thursday is the memorial of the martyrdom of our patron saint, St. John the Baptist. So there's special information about this beautiful memorial where we celebrate St. John the Baptist shedding his blood for Christ. And we will have Mass as usual at 8 a.m. on Thursday, and Eucharistic Adoration from 3 to 6 p.m. That day. Finally, thank you all for being here, for putting in the effort, making the time to be at Mass, to have your actions speak as loud as your words, that you love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, by worshiping Him the way He desires to be worshiped, in receiving His body and blood in Holy Communion. And so therefore I offer you and your loved ones a special solemn blessing for this upcoming week. The Lord be with you.
Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing.
Graciously enlighten your family, O Lord, we pray, that by holding fast to what is pleasing to you, they may be worthy to accomplish all that is good through Christ our Lord. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down on you and remain with you forever.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I also want to wish our cantor, Gigi Ox, well in college. She's going to Williams College in the leaving this week. So please, if you wish, greet her afterwards.
We are sent forth singing number 603, How Can I Keep From Singing, number 603.
My life flows on in endless song, above earth.